It pushes. It pulls. It's every farm's best friend. That's right. Today's topic is hoppers. Hi, I'm MistRazor, and welcome back to Redstone from Zero, a series where I teach you Redstone from its foundations, assuming you come in knowing absolutely nothing about it. As always, I recommend newcomers start at episode zero, but I'll do my best to be comprehensible even if you haven't. But enough recommending episode zero. It's time for hoppers. What hoppers do is pull items out of inventories above them, and push items into inventories they're pointing at whenever possible. They push before they pull, by the way. And by pointing at, I mean wherever the funnel of the hopper is pointing. To point a hopper into a particular block, just click to place the hopper against the block. As usual, if the block you want to place the hopper against has an inventory, you need to sneak click to place the hopper against it. Hoppers can point north, south, east, west, or down. They can't point up. If you try to place a hopper pointing up by placing it against the bottom of another block, it will instead point down. Hoppers themselves have 5-slot inventories, so hoppers can and do pull items from each other and push items into each other if they're set up to. But hoppers don't only transfer items in and out of inventories, they also collect item drops that are less than one block above them. And since one block exactly is the cutoff, it leads to the very useful behavior of hoppers being able to collect through blocks that are even just slightly shorter than a full block, like path blocks, soul sand, and mud. Interestingly, unlike most redstone components, applying redstone power to a hopper turns it off rather than on. So watch out for that when designing redstone machines, because it trips up many beginners who don't understand why their hopper is broken all of a sudden. If a hopper isn't collecting or transferring items, the first thing you should do is check if the hopper is somehow being powered, because that's the problem most of the time. Hoppers have a transfer rate of 2.5 items per second. Obviously, they can't transfer half an item, so this is an average. It's not that hopper transfers happen at random. They have a consistent 4 redstone tick cooldown between each push/pull, server lag permitting. But because 0.4 doesn't go into one cleanly, that means that some 1-second intervals will have 2 items transferred, and other 1-second intervals will have 3 items transferred, just because of how the redstone ticks align with real-life seconds. The cooldown period for hoppers is shared between collection and transfers in Java Edition. That is, if an item gets pushed into hopper B by hopper A, it starts a 4 redstone tick cooldown before it can push, pull, or collect again, even if it was empty before and hadn't pushed, pulled, or collected anything. But the collection cooldown and transfer cooldown in Bedrock Edition are separate from each other. Most of the time, this doesn't make a difference, but keep it in mind if you're building something with hoppers that requires very precise timing. And speaking of timing, let's take a moment to talk about efficiency. And I don't mean farm efficiency, I mean computational efficiency. Now, you may be wondering, Mist, why should I care about that? You should care about that because when you finally perfect the awesome redstone build you made in your single-player creative world and go to show it off by building it on your SMP, like my Hyrule's SMP series, and it lags the entire rest of the server, the other players aren't going to think, wow, what a cool redstoner. They're going to think, what did I do to deserve being on the same server as that idiot redstoner? So if you only ever play Minecraft single-player, you can ignore efficiency to a degree, but if you want to make and keep friends on multiplayer, you should at least know enough about efficiency to avoid building lag machines. So, let's talk efficiency. In Java Edition, hoppers require less processing power when they have an inventory to pull from immediately above them, instead of air or building blocks, which is why you'll often see chains of hoppers topped with composters in optimized Java farms. This is because the fewer inventory slots the hopper has to check, the more efficient it is, so composters are an ideal choice since they're cheap to craft and have only one pseudo slot for the hopper to check, the bone meal slot. As a side note, double chests with their 54 inventory slots are basically the best way to make your hoppers slow. It's not the end of the world to use them sometimes, I certainly do, just don't go overboard. Interestingly, Bedrock Edition hopper efficiency works basically in the opposite way of Java Editions. In Bedrock Edition, hoppers with air or building blocks immediately above them are the most efficient, and hoppers with inventories above them are less efficient. So, if you're adapting a Bedrock farm to Java, don't forget to add composters. And if you're adapting a Java farm to Bedrock, don't forget to remove any unnecessary composters. The thing is, though, as efficient as hoppers that only pull from inventories or solid blocks are, farms pretty much require hoppers that actually collect item drops. If you've never seen a farm built with a giant floor of hoppers to collect everything, great! It's a simple way to collect things, but it's also a bad idea, mainly because it scales horrendously. A 5x5 floor of hoppers needs 25 hoppers, which isn't too bad. The lag from a single hopper is pretty small. Using that same method in a 100x100 room results in a floor made of 10,000 hoppers. And that small amount of lag times 10,000 adds up pretty quick, especially on a server with multiple areas loaded at once. Not to mention it costs 50,000 iron ingots and 20,000 logs to build. So how do we build big farms that collect tons of items if a mere 100x100 farm with a hopper floor for collection is a lag factory? Enter the hopper minecart, or hopper cart for short. Hopper minecarts are great for three reasons. 1. They can cover a lot of ground easily, just by following a set rail path. 2. They can collect items through full-height blocks compared to a regular hopper needing short blocks like soul sand or mud above them to pull items through. This means a hopper cart traveling under a solid block can still collect items that fall on top of the block. 3. They collect and pull items fast. A hopper pulls 2.5 items per second, one item every 4 redstone ticks. A hopper cart pulls 20 items per second, which is the same as 2 items per redstone tick or 1 item per game tick. The hopper cart has only one real downside, and that's that it can't push items at all. When it's collecting items and pulling items from inventories, it's the greatest of all time. When it comes time to push those items into another inventory, it can't do that. You're stuck with regular hoppers for that job. So a simple hopper cart collection system looks like this. A hopper cart follows a set path that goes underneath the platform that catches items. It collects items from above it, then travels over the regular hoppers, which pull items out of it and puts them into the storage system. The part at the end looks a lot like this. As the hopper cart runs over it, you can see it pulls 9 items out as the hopper cart passes over it. But we can do better than that. So instead, we can build something like this, where we have hopper carts sitting on top of regular hoppers, and take advantage of the hopper cart's ability to pull things out really fast, and use them as a buffer that these regular, slower hoppers can pull from. You can only place minecarts on rails, by the way. So to get hopper carts here, you can either place rails on the hoppers, place the hopper carts, then carefully break the rails, or just put the hopper carts on the rails next to them and manually push them over the hoppers, which is what I did. And note that we use gravel, sand, or other gravity blocks because we can't directly place a block where a minecart already is. But gravel is able to fall into place even where we can't place blocks directly. And that's what allows us to put rails on top of the gravel. This approach pulls out 25 items each time the hopper passes over the hopper carts, compared to only 9 items when passing over plane hoppers, so it's definitely worth the extra effort if your farm has a high output. Alright, the next build I'm about to show you is a nice little redstone build you should burn into your memory forever, because it's possibly the most versatile clock you'll ever need to use. I'll explain how it works step by step. This is a hopper clock, also sometimes called an Etho hopper clock or an Etho clock after its inventor Etho, who is something of a Minecraft legend. The reason it's so useful is that it's a configurable clock. Depending on how many items you place in the hoppers, its clock cycle length can vary from 8 redstone ticks, 4/5 of a second, for one item, all the way up to 4 minutes and 16 seconds for 5 full stacks of items. Also, I'm planning to talk about comparators in the next episode, but for this build, all you need to know about how they work is that when a comparator is reading from a block with an inventory, it outputs a redstone signal if the inventory contains anything, and it doesn't output any signal if the inventory is empty. In a hopper clock, the two hoppers point into each other, and the two comparators measure the inventory of the two hoppers. When the comparators output, they strongly power the building block, which powers the redstone dust that's next to it. When powered, the redstone dust makes the sticky piston extend. And to be clear, you need sticky pistons for this clock, because even though it looks like the block of redstone is getting pushed, it's actually getting pulled. If you try to build it with regular pistons, it won't have the block updates it needs, and will just sit there instead of pushing the block of redstone when we want it to. Anyway, the block of redstone sits next to one of the hoppers, locking it. This allows the other hopper to push its contents into the locked hopper at a rate of 2.5 items per second. Once the unlocked hopper is completely empty, its comparator stops outputting a redstone signal, depowering the building block and redstone dust, causing the sticky piston on that side to retract. Since it's a sticky piston, it pulls the block of redstone along with it when it retracts. And pulling back the block of redstone powers the now empty hopper, locking it, and unlocks the formerly locked hopper, allowing it to start pushing items into the newly locked hopper. The newly locked hopper's comparator starts outputting a redstone signal as soon as it's no longer empty, making the sticky piston on that side try to extend. And the two sides continue the cycle of the hoppers emptying into each other, then pulling the block of redstone back and locking that side's hopper once it's empty. You can take a redstone output from it by placing redstone dust by the block of redstone, so it's powered in one position and unpowered in the other, and that gives you your clock signal. You can also build a one-wide vertical Etho hopper clock. It's exactly the same, you just move the redstone dust, sticky pistons, and block of redstone on top of the hoppers, instead of right next to them. So give building an Etho clock a try. They're really versatile. Okay, now that you know how hoppers work, let's build something cool with what we learned today. This time, I decided to build a short parkour course. It's pretty simple, and it only has three real sections to it. This part controls when the wall blocks come out and push you off the ledge. Just like over there, it's a regular Etho hopper clock under the hood. As you can see, it's pushed out half the time and pulled in half the time, which matches the position of the redstone block in the hopper clock. This next part controls the head hit blocks that prevent you from making the jump most of the time. We used a vertical Etho clock for this part, specifically using the redstone torch to turn on briefly once every clock cycle. When it powers on, we use the repeaters to lengthen the pulse to 4 redstone ticks, and use 2 repeaters on the far side to add a second 4-tick delayed pulse, effectively lengthening the pulse to 8 redstone ticks. The torches power the pistons with quasi connectivity, but every cycle they depower for 8 redstone ticks, so you can make the jump. Last, we have these jaws that open and close, blocking the way to the goal. You guessed it, it's another hopper clock under the hood. This one has redstone dust lines leading to the top and bottom sticky pistons to make the jaws open and close. So, let's see if we have what it takes to actually beat the parkour course. Ta-da! Definitely my first attempt. Yep, no editing trickery here. Anyway, before we end, let's go over what we talked about today. 1. Redstone power deactivates or locks hoppers, rather than activating them. 2. Hoppers pull items from directly above and push items in the direction of their funnel, north, south, east, west, or down. That is, they can push items in any direction except up. 3. In Java Edition, cover hoppers that don't need to pull from anything with composters to increase their efficiency. In Bedrock Edition, leave hoppers uncovered or cover them with solid blocks to increase their efficiency. 4. Hoppers can collect item drops that are less than one block above them, allowing hoppers to pull items through short blocks, like path blocks, soul sand, and mud. 5. Hopper carts can collect item drops that are one complete block above them, allowing them to pull items through full blocks, and efficiently collect from large areas, so don't make hopper floors, use hopper carts instead. 6. You can use gravity blocks like gravel and sand to bury hopper carts and allow rails to pass over them, increasing the speed at which you can pull from passing minecarts. If you want to get really fancy, you can bury them with concrete powder, and then wet it to encase the hopper carts in solid concrete. As always, if you have questions, feel free to leave a comment and I'll do my best to explain things to you. If you enjoyed this episode and think it deserves a like, I greatly appreciate it. And if you haven't already, don't forget to subscribe as well. It helps the channel a lot. Finally, I want to give a special thanks to everyone who has watched, liked, commented, and subscribed. In the time since I published the previous Redstone from Zero lesson, I've gone from about 90 subscribers to over 400 subscribers. And the Observer's video has over 5,000 views, both of which totally blow me away. You've left so many wonderful comments that I'm more motivated than ever to continue down this path. With that, thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye!